The multiversal crime fighters of the House of Heroes are ready to ride again to a brand new adventure. All this and more in the pages of Justice League Incarnate issue number 1. Let's hop on in together and find out what happens next, shall we? Alrighty then, so this brand new Joshua Williamson miniseries begins over in Earth 8, a universe that will seem pretty familiar to comic fans out there. It's home to the Retaliators, who are, yeah, they're the DC Multiverse's version of the Avengers. The Retaliators are having themselves a little soiree that ends up getting crashed by a brand new character going by the moniker Dr. Multiverse. Multiverse has come here today to tell the Retaliators of the death of Machine's Head, aka their Iron Man stand-in. Machine Head had actually died in the pages of Infinite Frontier, which Justice League Incarnate, this series you're reading right now, is a direct sequel to. Machine Head's death couldn't come at a worse time either, as there are cracks beginning to form in the multiverse, and it's at this moment the Retaliators' greatest foe, Tartarus, who is very clearly meant to be Thanos, attacks New York City in hopes of enacting his greatest plan. Oh, it's not an infinity quest, it's an eternity quest, don't you know? Legally distinct. Now, Machine Head wasn't the only one who was lost at the end of Infinite Frontier. Barry Allen the Flash had also gone missing, and it's because of that the House of Heroes is down a member. They're going to need a speedster and bad if they ever hope to use the quantum treadmill to fix all the problems in the multiverse. That's why President Superman and Flashpoint Batman have come to China on Earth Zero in hopes of recruiting Avery Ho. You may know her if you read the Flash book. She received Speed Force powers due to the Speed Force storms, and for the last little bit, she's been acting as the Flash of China. At first, Calvin and Thomas are unsure if this young girl can fill the boots of the Flash, but it seems before Barry's disappearance, he said that if anything should happen to him, he wanted her to take his place on Justice League Incarnate, which is of course interesting, as Wally and even Jay are out there as options, meaning that probably Barry knows something about Avery that the others don't. Avery's also pretty easy to get on the team too. As soon as she sees a boom tube, she believes everything this strange Batman and Superman from another world are telling her. The real info dump though comes from a character called Dino Cop, who explains that after the last battle with Darkseid, these cracks in the multiverse have begun to form. The belief is that Darkseid used the Flash on purpose to try and create these cracks so that he could steal whatever amazing power exists beyond the worlds as we know them. In fact, Darkseid even gave it a name at the end of the previous storyline, and that is the Great Darkness, which is almost certainly a direct reference to the famous Legion of Superheroes story, The Great Darkness Saga, because Joshua Williamson loves his little references and callbacks. It's with the help of Avery the Flash, Justice League Incarnate are able to open up a portal to where they believe Darkseid may be hiding out, and wouldn't you just know it, that Earth is Earth 8. Of course, the heroes are all sadly too late. This universe has been decimated and most of the Retaliators lie dead. Thomas, being a doctor, tries to see to their Captain America stand-in, only to be turned away. It would seem that Machine Head was not some lone agent when it came to striking a deal with Darkseid. All the Retaliators knew what he was doing and actually gave him the go-ahead if it meant protecting their Earth from destruction. Not that it mattered, their entire Earth got messed up anyway. Naturally, this revelation absolutely horrifies President Superman and the others, who are firm believers in that there is always a choice and that striking a deal with someone like Darkseid represents a real dereliction of heroic duty, even if it did end up saving a lot of people for a small amount of time. It's here we also find out that Tartarus has come not to just do battle with his enemy, the Retaliators, but also to try and claim the power beyond the cracks for himself. Of course, Darkseid has other plans, refusing to be usurped in his great quest by someone he believes to be a pale echo imitation of himself. Hell, it's during the back and forth between these two villains we actually discover that Tartarus knew Darkseid. Well, he knew a Darkseid several retcons ago, and they had inked a treaty of sorts. This newer, truer, more powerful Darkseid, though, recognizes no bargains and is ready to kill Tartarus if it means claiming his ultimate prize. It's during the big scuffle between the heroes and villains we actually end up learning something rather interesting about Dr. Multiverse. Apparently, she, like Darkseid, is the only version of herself that exists in the multiverse. The Doctor also seems to possess some sort of multiversal vision, meaning that when she looks at President Superman after he saves her, she sees not only Calvin, but every other version of Superman across the multiverse. Now, the good guys are unfortunately in no position to challenge Darkseid right now, so they need to make a very tactical retreat. Luckily, with the Flash's Speed Force abilities and Dr. Multiverse's powers combined, they're able to move the multiversal crowd back to another world in hopes that Darkseid won't be able to claim it just yet. Unfortunately, now it's a race between everyone to try and reach the crack before the other. The heroes also unfortunately end up losing contact with the rest of their team over at the House of Heroes, but the House of Heroes have their own business cut out for them at the moment, as Orion, son of Darkseid and new god character, makes his appearance known. He figures that if the Justice League Incarnate are going to be fighting his father, then he most definitely wants a piece of it. Sadly, Orion is as ever as subtle as a sledgehammer to the face. He was so gung-ho about reaching the House of Heroes, he didn't bother to realize that he was being followed by Kalibak and the armies of Apocalypse. And it's on that note right there the comic comes to a close, everybody. And so that was Justice League Incarnate issue number one, and once again, Joshua Williamson does a great job kicking off this new series. In fact, it manages to carry pretty much all the momentum that Infinite Frontier had into this new book. In fact, that's really my only minor complaint. If you were picking up this book because you like the concept of Justice League Incarnate and wanted to follow them around, I hope you realize that you're reading a sequel and that you might be a little lost. It's cool to see Avery Ho get some elevation, the interplay between Calvin and Thomas is as great as it's always been, and the continued promise to get to visit other fun and interesting DC worlds out there in the multiverse is more than worth the price of admission. Overall, I'd give this one a very solid 8 out of 10. Good stuff.
Hey there everyone, it's your pal Cape Jewel again, and if you're seeing my face right now, that means you watched to the end of the video, and I'll always be grateful for that. Retention helps in this crazy YouTube game, and so does becoming a patron. If you head on down to the description, you can find a link to my Patreon page. Recently just redid all the tiers, a lot of cool stuff offering up there, exclusive commentaries, exclusive polls, behind the scenes concept art for Capes and Quests, that's the brand new D&D show I've started soon. Never been a better time to become a patron. You can become a patron for as little as a dollar a month and help the channel grow and, you know, help me continue to deliver content like what you just saw. So I want to thank you all, and I will see you again next time. Bye-bye.